What's up, everybody? Welcome to another episode of the Ableton Music Producer Podcast. Before we get launched into today's episode with AJ Ramirez, it's going to be a good one. I want to let you know this episode is sponsored by Melodix. It's an app that helps you build your skills and confidence on the MIDI keyboard, pad controller, or electronic drums. I find it super fun. I have a push, I've used it on my push, and I've used it on my Akai MPK Mini and my Arteria Keylab. It's pretty fun just to plug in your MIDI controller and just jam on it, and has different lessons and songs that make practicing fun. It has a huge lesson variety and learning structure that helps you. It's a good way to look forward to practicing every day with gamifying the experience of music and making music. So download Melodix, go to melodix.com, M-E-L-O-D-I-C-S.com, and use the promo code LPO-20, like Live Producers Online, LPO-20, and save yourself 20% on any subscription plan. Also, last but not least, I am doing my weekly group sessions for only 10 bucks a month still. You can join me and other producers using Ableton. Every week we vote on a topic, and then we go deep into that topic. Today was with a guest, Robbie Sko, my homie. He came in and taught a lot about CliffX 101 and gave a big spreadsheet to all of the group session members, a list of his favorite CliffX commands to do live looping and creative stuff in Ableton. That's just one example for today. I've done other group sessions on mixing, blah, blah, blah. Go to liveproducersonline.com, hit the fat green join button. Would love to see you on a weekly basis on Zoom and help you learn some more cool stuff in Ableton Live. That's enough about that. Let's jump into today's episode with AJ. And thanks for listening, everybody. Welcome, everybody, to another episode of the Ableton Music Producer Podcast. This is Dan Giffen. Today, we are blessed to hang out with AJ Ramirez. He is a producer, engineer, musician, a show programmer. He's worked with major artists, including Reggie Watts, Ariana Grande, Harry Styles, Corey Henry. The list goes on and on. AJ is the head of production at Electronic Creatives, and he manages Multihouse Studios, which is a dedicated space for music and creative arts. What's up, man? Thanks for hanging out today.
Thanks for having me. Much appreciated. Yeah,
I love your bedroom setup right now. I can see there's like a wealth of music gear like crammed into your space.
Yeah, you know, I do cram it with space here. I'll just defend that the apartment itself is bigger than this one room you got a view of here.
Nice. Closet looks very organized, though. I feel like you kind of have to be in this line of business.
Completely. Yeah, no, this is the home studio. And then, as you just mentioned, I have I co-run a studio in downtown LA that's sort of this model of any kind of creative can come in there and do something. So it's you know, we have a production setup for music and a vocal booth and that sort of thing, and synths and instruments. But then we also have a photo space and also just a nice couches to kick it on. So
I know it's cool, man. It's a nice looking space. I follow you on the gram. I saw that like you've been doing, it looks like more like photography type of stuff, and you have a nice like screen set up with lights.
Yeah, totally. And that's, I know it's something you were wanting to get into, but sort of like what's everyone who used to be touring been doing in 7, 8, 9 months? And yeah, one of them has definitely been more visual projects for me.
Yeah, we should definitely talk more about that in a second. But I met you back in the day, Master Track with Laura Escade. So she's been on the podcast, and you actually joined the podcast with her and the Electronic Creative team. And that was before COVID and all the craziness and stuff. But yeah, you definitely have a unique spin on the music industry, because I think you've seen a lot of both sides as far as the live performance, and also you work in the studio a lot. So out of all the guests I've had on this podcast, it's interesting to pick your brain on both sides, because I know a lot of people are either just married to the live performance show design, or they're just like studio rats, and like you do a lot of both on a very high level. So yeah, it's really interesting. But like, how did you get started with the music production? Like, where did that come about?
Well, I think like a lot of people, GarageBand was free on the Macs back in the day.
Yeah, right.
And they were still like those multicolor, kind of translucent, deep Macs. You remember those?
Yeah.
I had one of those at my piano teacher's spot. And basically, she actually had us do 30 minutes of piano lessons and then 30 minutes of, I was about to say production lessons, but it really was just making loop-based beats with GarageBand loops. And I mean, that's where I really started diving in. And you know, of course, by the time I was a teenager, playing guitar, in bands and like recording out of garages and back houses and that sort of thing. And then fast forward further and further. So did Berkeley out in Valencia and really honed in on all the, I guess all the know-how and all the sort of demands of what it means to do this kind of work in a professional context. And then fast forward one more time to the end of the tape. It's 2020 in LA, and all of that, like you say, is coming into play, both live and studio, especially because a lot of what we can do now in terms of music production work is geared towards performance, live performances, streaming concerts, you know, but like a lot of them are happening in studios or in alternative spaces. And then you come and mix it at the studio. And yeah, as a guy who's been running playback and doing like live effects and sort of that side of engineering for the past 3 years, it has definitely been cool to dig further and further into like studio side of it, post-production. And pre-production, I guess. So just to say basically that a lot of gigs for me lately, like past weeks, have been shoots that have actually involved a whole lot of mixing and a whole lot of like studio side stuff.
Nice.
Gone along with the live performance.
Yeah. Yeah, totally. You know, when I was in MasterTrack, there's a lot of handling of stems. And as you know, more than anybody, there'll probably be an artist at some point and be like, nah, let's just scratch that. Or could you make this sound better or fatter? There's a sound design mixing component to building these live rigs and playback in Ableton with these major artists that you've worked with. So I could see a lot of crossover going back and forth, and having experience as like an audio engineer definitely plays a key into being able to get the best sound possible on stage, I'm sure, in a lot of ways.
Yeah, 100%. And engineers I've worked with, some of them have one philosophy or the other with requests like that, like, hey, make this fatter. You know, add some verb to this or that. For me, like, I really like to lean into that side of the work, you know, sort of not limit the role to being, you know, just pressing play basically. And like, especially working with musical directors who are down to sort of really get in the weeds with reimagining tracks for live, you know?
Yeah.
And yeah, so for some engineers, the philosophy is really like, oh, I don't do that. Have your producer send me the stems and I'm going to play them, and maybe I'll do an edit or two. But
yeah,
definitely having your tools on hand and well sharpened, so to speak, like to where you know which EQ you're going to move. One aspect that it's really come into play with has been with live recordings for shoots like this, right? So for example, I had to do some processing on backgrounds that were recorded recently, background vocals, but they were recorded on a stage in a rehearsal space where there are live drums and other stuff going on. So it was like, all right, we gotta find some ways to isolate this and do some really fine-tuned gating.
Gating the shit out of every mic.
Gating it, man. There's a Waves plugin, and I really don't go for a lot of Waves stuff, but they have this thing, primary source enhancer or expander, which is based on a Neve unit called the primary source enhancer. Like a smart gate, and it just, it's used for isolating vocal sources.
Interesting. It's called primary source is the VST.
PSE, primary PSE. Source expander. Yeah.
Okay. Interesting.
That's been like a new tool in my toolkit that keeps coming into play.
Nice. No, it's funny you mentioned that, because I just ran into that myself. I did a green screen shoot with my band Philia, and I recorded live drums. And the room acoustics were not at all what I was expecting. And just a lot of surgery after the fact to make it sound tight for a live music video. So I understand the struggles are real.
Totally, man.
I do want to shift and talk a little bit more about how you've had to make a quick jump from live playback with EC, right? Electronic Creatives. And it seems like you're shifting a lot more and doing multi-house studios. What's your prediction like for the future of live tours? Like, do you think it's going to look exactly like it did before? It's going to bounce back maybe like 1, 2, 3, 4 years. Obviously, nobody knows everything for certain, but I'm just kind of curious to pick your brain on that.
Yeah, man. Well, I guess I'll start with the note about having been doing more live and the shift to studio, you know, that's been, I mean, broadly what's been going on in the past months for a whole bunch of musicians. You know, you can't go out, go in. Going into the studio, working with, you know, the artists that I make produce tracks for, has definitely been something I've more investing in. And I think what it has also led me to realize or just reaffirm is this fact that the in doing this kind of work, it's kind of a piecemealed kind of lifestyle, you know, like it's a gig here, it's a gig there, and then it's a record here, it's a record there, and then there's a bunch of a bunch of other stuff in there that you would never have anticipated. So, you know, I wasn't working a lot of shoots prior to this year, and now like it's a lot of that. I guess I had this conception, like when I was a lot younger, especially being more surrounded by 9-to-5 type lifestyles, is like, okay, take a job at a studio and then you work there and then that's your thing, right? Yeah. And what I've come to realize is not only that's not exactly how it works, but it's not exactly how I would want it to work. So, you know, while this year has been tumultuous in terms of taking the stability out of the equation, for me, which is I've been relying on touring and gigging in the live context for the past several years, it's allowed me to like add more things to the mix, basically, and kind of diversify, piecemealing together like a whole series of projects that kind of comprise my whole like lifestyle and everything in a way that I hope to sustain beyond the end of the pandemic. I mean, whatever that even means, right?
Exactly.
So, you know, examples aside from gigs here, like streaming gigs or shoots, and besides studio production for different artists, it's like also been a chance for me to dip into sound design. So like I'm working for Output,
awesome
for Arcade.
Yeah, I love Arcade. It's a great plugin.
Hell yeah. Yeah, it's been a whole other area that I've been digging into. I've also been pitching tracks for Sync, you know, and like landing stuff here and there. So there's so many avenues in music production, you know, and mm-hmm. it's just been a chance for me to, and a lot of people I know, to kind of spread out. And for that reason, yes, I hope touring comes back in the way that it was, generally speaking, broadly speaking, and I know it will long term. Mm-hmm. You know, we will have large gatherings again. I don't think that's going to be within the next 6 months.
Probably not. Yeah.
I think summer 2021 is kind of the earliest that I can imagine.
Yeah.
That kind of thing happening.
It's interesting. I'm sure you know who Mark Ribollet is, who did like the first drive-in tour. I think he was the first guy to actually do still a scalable tour across the US this year, since everything. But yeah, it is interesting to see when all that is going to come back. And you're right. Like a lot of people have had to become really creative in their profession of music, whatever that looks like, and shifting, especially if they're in the live performance side. I see that with a lot of artists too right now. And I'm curious, like what are you seeing artists doing or being more creative with that is interesting that maybe hasn't been done as much before?
Well, I think extending it as far as the creating revenue part, that's a trickier question.
Right.
In terms of what people have done to be creative, I've seen some interesting kind of movement in the whole XR AR. So, you know, at the VMA, so there's some folks I know out here in LA who work with artists and have been diving into the XR world. So that's cross reality is the term. And they did, for example, the Lady Gaga performance at the VMAs recently, where she, you know, she was shot in this kind of, it was in a psych room, like on a psych wall that had two planes to it, right?
Yeah.
So sort of 3D psych wall. And they had her interacting in this virtual world, basically, right? Scale would shift around her and she'd be tiny in this large sort of animated room. And then next thing you know, she's like standing on this little disc flying around, right?
Yeah.
And so, well, I know that some of the people behind that have gotten there because of the fact that the normal touring world slowed way down, and it provided this space for them to create a whole new, or really just push this whole new thing.
Yeah.
For example, some of these people, it's like they were doing lighting and they were doing visual tour visuals and that sort of thing. And so it's like a new arena.
Yeah.
In that sense. Or like, for example, Anderson .Paak and a whole bunch of other artists have done festivals in other kinds of VR spaces, right? Like the Fortnite festivals.
Yeah.
So
And Tomorrowland did like a virtual fest too. That was really interesting.
Burning Man did it. You know, I didn't actually really, I didn't attend, so to speak.
Right.
And I didn't really catch much of like how it all went down as a user. But you know, I guess that's how real festivals are too, if you don't actually attend.
That's true. Yeah, it is. It's a wild thought to think about like all the advancements that's happened with XR or like VR or whatever, just because of this. I think it's forced people to become more creative and just try new things. I know a lot of artists or engineers that have had to become more flexible and kind of shift in a way that allows them to be outside the box to do something new right now. It seems like it's a very make or break year for a lot of people in the arts.
Yeah, man. It's like encouraging change, you know, and I think the best method is to just try to embrace that, you know, and try to run with it.
Yeah.
Some of this tech, a lot of this tech, if that's what we're talking about, has been around, but it's like without the impetus to have to learn it, you know?
Yeah.
A lot of us aren't gonna. Because it's like, we knew before this that we could remotely record with people across the world, right?
Yeah.
But now, okay, well, now we got to. And so now everyone's figuring out we can do audio movers and you can like send audio through network, all different kinds of ways.
Yeah. Have you tried doing much of that with success on any projects?
Yeah, totally. Not a ton, but like it definitely works and it works great.
Yeah. Yeah. I know we have like an Ableton certified trainer meetup, or we used to like every week with Laura, and they tested a lot of that stuff out and it works pretty amazing. If the other producer you're working with is technically savvy in that way, it could definitely work. Yeah.
Hey, just wanted to give a quick reminder. If you haven't checked out Melodix yet, you can do a free trial or save 20% on any of their membership plans. And they are kind enough to do this by using the discount code LPO-20, Live Producers Online-20. Check it out. It's a great way to improve your skills, finger drumming, or just playing keys. There's a lot of different options in there. So melodix.com, discount code LPO-20. And now back to today's episode.
Well, let's talk more about like your multi-house studios. I think it's like a good segue. What have you learned about running your own studio or creative space as like a manager of a studio now? What have you learned in that process?
Yeah, it's a good question. Well, the way our studio works is a little unique. So like I already mentioned, it's sort of this multi-use creative space. Right. It's not strictly a recording studio. It's not strictly a photo space or whatever.
It's in downtown LA too, right?
Yeah, it's in the Fashion District.
Nice.
What has been interesting about our model is that we have people commit to one or two sessions a week, and then they stay with us for multiple months. So unlike a lot of studios, it's all walk-ins, or maybe someone's booking it out for a longer period of time.
Yeah,
we really share the space. At any given point, we usually have like 7 to 10 people using the space every month on a regular basis, and then a few additional shoots that may happen or something like that. I feel like I learn something every time I go in there, especially with someone else to work, you know? In terms of like managing it, there's definitely been learnings on my behalf with just watching how it shifted around COVID. So COVID hit, no one really knew what was going on and no one was leaving. I mean, we were under stay at home, right? Certainly the studio slowed down for a minute there. And then we quickly realized my partner in the space, Kimmy, she and I realized after about a month, we're like, all right, well, it's going to come back. People are going to come into the studio, especially because they can't do performances. And we need to figure out how we can run this and make it safe, make it sanitary and, you know, kind of ethically run our operation.
Yeah.
So certainly, like, we've done a whole bunch of deep cleaning and that sort of thing, and we've had to implement some new protocols around use of the space and people capacity and that sort of thing.
Yeah, just showering and hand sanitizer every time somebody walks in the door.
Yeah. I don't know if you know the Fashion District, but it's a grimy area.
Yeah.
And so, yeah, we certainly have had to up our
cleanliness. I gotta raise the standard. Hand out hazmat suits to all your clients.
Oh man, probably walk down the street in the Fashion District and find some hazmat suits. Maybe we should do that.
Yeah, there you go, man.
What it's forced us to do, though, really is just get more legit with our kind of setup. You know, it's a warehouse space. I mean, we converted a warehouse space and made it kind of nice. Yeah. But you know, truthfully, we have people going in and out all the time, and to manage it and sort of be responsible for that has just been a process of kind of like realizing, okay, well, we've really committed to this thing and we've invested a whole bunch in the space, and the community like supports it being there. You know, people want to use it and are really excited to, and it's like, all right, well, we have a duty to kind of uphold this now. And like,
yeah, it's a nice space. It looks great online.
Yeah. I hope you can come and check it out in LA.
Yeah, for sure, man. I don't know the next time I'm going to be on a plane, but yeah, eventually, someday, yes. Is this something where people can come in and use all the gear at their own will, or are you or somebody else like a dedicated engineer for them?
Yeah, so we set it up. It is a two-click studio. So everything comes online with two clicks. And that's just because we separated the power out on two separate circuits. Basically,
okay. You
can plug it. So most people, anyways, these days run their own laptops, right? You come in, we run a universal audio system.
Love it.
So you plug in the one cable and pop on the two power conditioners, and then 16 channels come live.
Nice.
And a couple of them are sort of open for you to plug anything else you might want to bring in there. So it really is made to be able to operate on your own as a producer or someone, an artist who just needs to be able to get signal into the machine, you know?
Yeah.
And then certainly me and some of my good friends who I also work with, like at Electronic Creators, other engineers, Greg Somerville, Royce Whitaker.
Oh, yeah.
Homies of mine and excellent engineers and music makers. You know, we're all sort of on call for engineering, and it happens, you know?
Yeah.
I'm in track a vocalist or come in and just kind of show the studio setup to someone and then bail out, let them do their session.
Cool. Yeah, no, I mean, I find there's several studios in Indianapolis that have kind of moved to that model. Rather than having an in-house engineer always there, it's kind of like, well, if you're skilled enough, you know, you're just renting the space really at that point.
Totally. And you know, that's actually something interesting that I was thinking about, kind of going back to this thing I mentioned, like, as a kid thinking like, okay, I'm going to be an audio engineer and I'm going to work at a studio. And like, that's the dream. Right. And realizing that in those situations, sometimes like as a house engineer at a studio or whatever, often what you're doing is bringing someone in, showing them how it works, and then laying low while they do it, you know, because gone are the days where audio gear is relatively inaccessible to the average person and much less like the know-how to run it, you know.
Yeah.
40 years ago, you really needed engineers to be in the studio to be patching for you and to be leveling and all kinds of stuff.
Yeah.
So, you know, that's part of the reason why like I also enjoy the sort of piecemeal gig lifestyle and projects left and right, is because it doesn't have me just sitting at a studio like overseeing everything but not really doing anything necessarily. And you know, obviously mad respect to all the engineers who are running big studios like that,
right?
Who bring in artists and have them use one channel to record a vocal.
Totally. That's the real thing. And producers, and I've said this on the podcast several times, but like everybody has to wear a lot of hats these days. It seems like, you know, if you're a producer, then you probably might also be an engineer, and you might also be an instrumentalist that like records on that project for that artist.
And you're also, you know, like these other things, the marketing person, all these other things at once, you know, wearing a lot of hats, having a lot of skills goes a long way, especially in a place like where you are. I mean, LA is the mecca of
like
music production. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. And of just multi creatives, you know.
Exactly.
And I really try to embrace this idea of like not just being one thing, professionally speaking, as well as like on a more personal level. But I think what I also struggle with, though, is like, okay, where do I draw the line, you know? So Right. Total other bit of my background that I didn't even get into. I did, when I was like 17, 18, heading to college, actually decided to put guitar music on the back shelf for a minute. I did a design and art direction degree. I worked in advertising as a junior art director for a bit before back over to music. So there's been this process of me, or a process for me in the past months of like getting back into visual projects and getting back into Adobe and into tablet drawing and different stuff. Like, okay, so now like, do I add the title designer back to my thing? Like, what titles, you know, matter? And we even need to stick to like a certain set, you know? And that's the thing I've realized is I can be a few things on one day and in one context and a few other things in another context. And the one area that gets difficult for me is knowing where to stop.
Yeah.
Where to just really hone in and focus.
Yeah.
And make sure that I'm doing like my one or my few main things really well, you know?
Yeah. Like in MasterTrack, Laura, one thing and several people said is like staying in your lane. You know, because like understanding what you're really good at, just sticking in with it and just going with it. Because otherwise, you're just this like scatterbrained person running all over and overcommitting to everything because you're spread so thin with all these different skills. Yeah.
Right. And it's not like a great look to be like, oh, I can do that and I can do that and I can do that and I can do that. And then like you can take it too far to where people are like, well, can they really do like all of these things and as good as they say they can?
Yeah.
That's true. Knowing where to just like pause, tap the brakes and basically be like, today, this is as far as I'm kind of extending my outreach,
right.
My skill set, you know, like, especially so in the playback context, that's kind of coming back to an earlier part of our conversation. It's like, sure, maybe the artist is telling you to reach for an EQ and like change something about the mix. And, you know, yeah, maybe because it's the artist like directing you, you ought to do it. But then where do you draw the line between like, okay, I'm not here to mix today, man. Like, you know, like it can be a slippery slope in that sense.
Yeah.
You're doing two jobs, right?
That's true. And then you like don't get any sleep and you're up all night and cranky the next day for finishing that project.
For sure. Happened to me recently where I was both doing playback and mixing. Doing the Pro Tools mix of the performance and then delivering for broadcast and everything. I committed to both and it was great. And I really enjoyed doing that, but it 100% meant that I, you know, went to bed at 11 and then woke up super early to go to my studio to mix it the next day before the next rehearsal. So,
yeah, no, I feel that, man. Like I am not one to preach about overcommitment because I've done that many times around. And like, I find I don't mix as well, like, or perform when I'm not in a good rested headspace, you know, like just from making decisions and like mixing or working on a project. Like if you don't take care of your health, that's going to affect your work, like for sure in a lot of ways in my experience. So,
and thank God for the fact that we fatigue in that way, because if we could keep just going, we really just would.
Yeah.
But for doing music, you know, after, so at like, you know, 80, 85 dB in the room, you can do that for about 8 hours before your ears get fatigued.
Right.
But after that, they really do. And then mentally you have fatigue set in too. And if not for that, yeah, we would just push ourselves all the way. But so we have a good reason to stop.
Yeah.
And give ourselves that break as music guys and girls.
Maybe when like Elon Musk's Neuralink comes out, we can change that and we can all just be like robots that never stop working, get so much more done just all the time. A little chip in our brain just like recharges us.
It looks good though.
Yeah. Right. Man. So there was another really interesting project that you did, I don't know, what, a year and a half, 2 years ago, called Cages.
That was a really, really cool experience. You want to maybe mention that to people who don't know what that is?
Love to, yeah. So, yeah, about over two years ago, got the call to start working on this project, which was basically still in its nascency, although it had been in production for already like 4 years at that point. It's a immersive hologram musical with live performance mixed with holograms, basically. And it was super funny to me because they called me and they were like, yeah, we need someone to like do our Ableton mix and like, you know, make all the stage instruments talk to each other and so on. And we're like, yeah, maybe a week, maybe 2 weeks. And fast forward, I've still been working for them. I've been going down to the space and preparing some alternative shows and stuff with them. And now it's over 2 years later, right?
Yeah. Yeah. So,
background about Cages. Basically, some really amazing producers out here. One of whom is like a Max Martin guy, CJ Barron and Ben Romans, basically are the creators of this show. They teamed up with the record label that helped make it happen, Rebel One or State of the Art, and got a warehouse studio, a warehouse theater downtown in the Arts District. Over the process of about a year, converted it into this amazing like speakeasy entrance type bar gallery space, and then theater in the back. Then implemented this show called Cages, in which you have or had. So it was running for about, I think it was getting close to about 6 months that it was running and doing really well in LA before it before COVID hit in March. Yeah, during which you, as an attendee, kind of enter into this immersive space that is the world of the show, which is like this very Tim Burton.
It has almost this creepy kind of vibe to it. It's cool.
Creepy kind of, you know, alternative world in which the play itself is set. And then it's kind of like a pop opera. So just really well produced, amazing music, a little bit cinematic, a little bit theatrical, but really accessible. And live performance, so singing, backups, backup dancers, and stage cast. And then Ben Romans, who's the musical genius behind the thing in terms of composition, sits in this layer above the stage in which he has a piano, a Moog, a Whirly, main stage rig, so a bunch of MIDI sounds. And he basically scores on top of the performance tracks, which this company called L-Acoustics out in LA, they make this system called Elisa, which is a surround sound mixing engine that's completely customizable to any acoustic space. So basically, they mapped the theater.
Awesome.
They installed 19 channels of surround and then 4 subs suspended from the ceiling.
Wow.
And yeah, and in the Elisa engine, it's object oriented. So you basically assign a track from Pro Tools, because we were working in Pro Tools for months before we even brought it into Ableton, actually. You assign like an object from Pro Tools, a track rather, to a spatial object, and you host it as a VST in Pro Tools. And then it runs out to the Elisa engine, which actually does the math. You know, it plays in the space between your 19.
That's wild.
Sources or your 19 speakers, your outputs.
Yeah.
So yeah, so it's like this hour and a half show pretty much with really amazing music and the craziest surround sound you'll ever hear.
That's amazing.
And
that's pretty trippy.
Say nothing of the fact that the main actor, performer, CJ, is a human existing in this hologram world of the show.
Yeah.
So it's like Shepherd's Ghost illusion, the Tupac at Coachella thing. Like he looks like he's standing right next to these
other fake actors or whatever.
Yeah, exactly.
That's like wild.
Love with this animated character named Madeline, and then you know she's not as like, she doesn't have the same life that he does. So like, it's represented by the fact that she's a hologram. So anyways, it's like,
that's pretty amazing.
Music, get it, you know.
Yeah, the programming. I remember when I first met you, you were like pretty deep into programming that show and sounded like a lot. Like there was a lot of stuff going into it. It's really, really cool. Yeah. Some pretty state of the art stuff that was happening with the surround sound too. It's pretty dope.
Yeah, man.
Do you, What is like the next level of live performance that you see? I mean, we're talking about like the cinematic experience with like, you know, all this crazy surround sound. What do you think is going to be the next cutting edge thing when it comes to live shows when that comes back again? Like, what do you see in the future that's different than what we've normally seen for regular tours and shows as far as production or whatever?
Yeah, well, what this makes me think of is actually the only other hologram show that I've worked on. Which is hilarious that there's even more than one to me.
That's cool. But
it's the Whitney Houston hologram tour. Early this year, I think January, February, the tour went out. And basically, you know, Whitney Houston, rest in peace, she has been dead like 8 years, 9 years now only. Yeah. And they recreated from video of her old performances and CGI on top. All, you know, it's almost like a 2-hour show. A hologram performance in which she performs with a real band behind her. Costume changes where she spins around and then next thing you know, it's like 80s.
That's amazing.
So, you know, she spins around and then her hair is all 90s and she's doing the 90s tunes and so on.
That's incredible. So did they take actual video of her, I assume, from the past and then just basically like cut her out and then put her into this like hologram environment with the band? That's basically what they did.
Right. And she's like almost the only hologram aspect, which makes it look all the more real because
everything
you're seeing on stage is real.
That's wild.
The screen is obviously invisible. Yeah, I don't know the full extent of what they did. It was definitely like video from her performances and obviously audio from existing performances. And then, yeah, you know, some amount of CGI and so on. But just to say that I guess that's like the future. Not like she's even been gone that long and they already like recreated her and put her out on tour. So she was like that. I say she like she's a real person.
Right.
Like they were out on tour for like a month maybe or 6 weeks before COVID hit. So, wow. You know, it halted in its tracks. But I definitely think that like in a pandemic world, like, look, that's the artist doesn't have to worry about catching COVID if they're a hologram. You know what I'm saying?
Right.
Yeah. That's the liability on any tour is like
the
person being healthy. So,
right.
I imagine that's going to be pushed further and further, which really brings it to the Black Mirror episode of with Miley Cyrus. Did you watch that one?
I did not. No.
Okay, so it's basically the premise of what they did with Whitney. I mean, kind of. But basically, Miley she stars in this one Black Mirror episode, and she's playing a pop star. And it's very much this like candy pop kind of thing that she has been brought up into, except that she's getting sick of it, and she really wants to rebel and like make different music and like basically shed her pop star persona. But her management, I'm kind of gonna give it away, but you should still watch it anyways. Basically, her management is like, no, like you need to be the pop star that we created, and she's like, fuck that, I'm gonna do my own thing.
Right.
And they basically I'll just say they incapacitate her, and then they introduce the hologram version of her that they had been creating. And then
that sounds good. I need to watch that.
Yeah you should watch it.
Interesting.
Because, basically, like, they just needed her to build the persona, and then they can freeze her in time and just continue to sell this, you know, 22 or 3-year-old pop star persona that they've created, but the virtual version of it.
That's wild, man. You know Steve Primo from Savant Playback?
Yeah.
He and I had an interesting conversation going along the lines of that idea for the future of shows. As far as, like, VR, where everybody who has, like, an Oculus or whatever, where you can put on your VR goggles, can go to shows and like you can go around and actually meet and hang out with other people that are actually doing the same thing as you at a show, and then see that band. They're probably in front of a green screen at some remote studio and they're shooting a live actual video of them in this crazy mega, you know, massive stage with production and lights, and you feel like you're almost there. And a lot of these like VR goggles anyway and stuff, headsets, they have good speakers on them anyway, so it is like an immersive experience. But I think you always have people that want to be in person, like no matter what. It's just like that vibe, that experience, that energy is so much different in real life. But I think we'll probably see more of that kind of stuff happening too. That was interesting. Yeah.
In our lifetime, I think we'll see it become somewhat mainstream if the tech can become like have a low enough barrier to entry.
Yeah.
Cause like even at this point for me, like I'm not about to invest in an Oculus, you know?
Right. Same.
But like if it becomes to the point where like most people have them the way we have phones, then 100%.
Right.
And that sort of thing, I mean, it kind of like I was saying before, like it has existed already. It's just now that we're sort of being pushed further towards it. I was talking with actually, so Carlos Mosquera is the Pro Tools engineer out of L-Acoustics who I worked with most closely on the whole cages thing. And he's a brilliant dude. He mixes the Elisa system for like Bon Iver, Friend of House, for example, is one of his.
Nice.
But like in his spare time, he's been like creating virtual mix rooms in which people like from across, from wherever they are, like log in. I think they just do it without a headset on the computer, but basically show up at like a mixing session and they have these like virtual couches that you're sort of like sitting on.
Wait, what? So,
Pro Tools.
So you're like, hold on. So you're like showing up in a virtual studio and like pretending to mix, or you're actually mixing on those like, virtual computers? Like
he is like, for him, he'd be the engineer actually mixing, but then he'd be like hosting people in the studio.
Gotcha. So they could have like an actual high quality feed of what he's actually mixing for them.
Exactly.
That's but dope. Then
like, I think it goes as far as if you wanted to for it to be a binaural thing. So it's like, okay, as you approach the virtual mixing desk, you're like getting the more direct sound.
No way. Out of like the studio monitors or whatever?
At the room. Yeah. That's so there's wild. Like convolution happening to like recreate a mix room environment.
That sounds like a lot of work just for like a remote like mix session. That's cool though. I mean, that's pretty amazing. Yeah. I mean, would people pay extra for that? Maybe. I don't know.
But it gets people talking. So
it does. It's true. It's good PR. Right on, man. So last but not least, I know that you're busy. You've got stuff to do. Last conversation we had in person, I think, was just nerding out on like some of our favorite plugins and Ableton tools, because I know you do a lot of mixing as well. If you had to go down that rabbit trail, what are your top, say, two or three mixing plugins of all time that you use the most?
Damn. Okay. Specific to Ableton, are you saying?
It doesn't have to be Ableton. We'll start with plugins and then we can go to Ableton.
Man, well, yeah, like I had this conversation, the whole like you're stuck on an island and you can only take
one plugin. Yeah, because that makes a lot of sense. Like, first of all, I need an outlet. My laptop's going to die. Second of
all, like it's going to overheat. You can get sand up in there.
Yeah, definitely don't want that.
This is maybe a wild card. I don't know. For me, Trash too. Isotope Trash.
No way. Dude, Trash was my first love. It really was. It was my first love, man. Like back in the day, that OG Isotope plugin.
I didn't have Trash 1. I came on with Trash 2.
Yeah. No, I started using Trash 2, I think, it was within like a year or two after it was released, a long time ago.
It's super powerful. Pretty much because it's like more than one plugin. You know, you have like, you have multiband harmonics, so saturation, distortion, whatever. And then you have two stages of it. And then you have filtration of that harmonic, of those additional harmonics. So like EQs within those, right? And then you have two other EQs that you can apply pre or post. And then you have a dynamics section. And then you also have a convolution section. Mm-hmm. And I really like some of the IRs they have.
Yeah.
You can just get some really interesting tonal quality out of them. And then you also have a delay built in there. So it's like...
Everything you'd want, man. It's everything in life you've ever dreamed of that you need. Yeah, this is true. It's a one-stop shop. That's a good choice for sure. And you can, and I like the multi-band aspect too with the compressor. You can go multi-band on it. It's pretty surgical with the EQ. I'm a big fan. Yeah,
exactly. Yeah. And I'll just plug one more, no pun intended, which is the SSL G-Bus on UAD.
Yeah. I use that on my master for almost every single track. I love that thing. Yeah, it sounds thick. It's a good, thick, warm group hug.
And the only specific Ableton one I'll plug to round it out would be Convolution Reverb Pro.
Yeah. No, definitely, man. I love Pro. I think that's like the hidden gem of Ableton, really.
Right. Because, especially once they made it just bundled in with Live 10 with Max. You know what I mean?
Yeah. It's nice.
One way I really like to think about that processing is, you know, when you're adding, like, okay, you think of adding reverb, right? And you think, okay, so now I got the dry signal and then I have like the tail of the reverb. And okay, that's what adding reverb is. No, you can use, especially with convolution reverbs, like modeled off real spaces and stuff. There's a whole bunch in there that are really short, right? They're like a 0.1 second decay.
Yeah.
Some room, and it's not really even like a real room. It's like a drum head convolution or something like that. You could just use 100% wet signal of that to totally change the quality of a sound, you know?
Yeah. Yeah, you totally. You
can also drag in your own audio samples into Convolution Pro.
Mm-hmm.
Use it for other stuff. So
yeah. Powerful. Yeah. I have a friend, she went like out into like a bunch of caves and just recorded a balloon popping and made all of her own reverb that she uses on all of her tracks as like a unique sound. Yeah. No, Convolution Reverb for the win. It's good stuff, man. Dude, well, thank you for hanging out. It's good seeing your face. It's been a while. And last but not least, like, where's the best place for people to connect with you?
Sure. So on the gram, find me. You know, it's actually linked in my website, so I'll just give you that. So it's ajproductions.com, but it's ajaeproductions.com.
Right on. Yeah, on and there. We'll include links to the show notes, or in the show notes for this episode, so everybody can go there and find you.
Right on, yeah. I would say real fast, just basically also you could go check out multihousedtla.com. You can check out cagesdtla.com as well as electroniccreatives.com, the production company that I've been with and been working with for a while now. So those are the links.
Yeah, no, for sure, man. You're a busy guy doing a lot of stuff, but it's all good things. And thanks for hanging out, man. Tell Laura and Greg and everybody else Dan says hey.
Will do, dude. Thank you so much.
Yo, thank you for listening to today's episode. If you are interested in joining me and other producers, whether you are new to Ableton Live or you have a lot more experience with years of producing, every week we vote on a group topic. And if you go to liveproducersonline.com, click the fat green join button. If you join any membership plan, you'll have access to these weekly group sessions that I just mentioned. Would love to see you on the other side and help you level up your skills producing music as I continue to learn to do the same. Much love. Also, if you don't own Ableton Live, I would love to hook you up with the cheapest price that you'll find it. So go to liveproducersonline.com/buyableton, liveproducersonline.com/buyableton. And much love. Thanks for listening to the podcast. I'll see you next time.